From the WLOE and WMYN News and Public Affairs Department, this is Community Accents, connecting Rockingham County people, businesses, and services, recorded live on location and broadcast Monday through Friday at 8:30 a.m. and 6:30 p.m. Video production funding provided by the Rockingham County Business and Technology Center. Entrepreneur-focused, technology-enabled, future-driven.
Good morning and welcome to another edition of Community Accents right here on WLOE WMYN. I'm Kevin Suthard, Public Information Officer for the Sheriff's Office. Today is Friday, April the 19th, 2013. Sheriff Page could not be in the studio with us today, but we have a special treat this morning. We have Captain Daryl Crowder, who is the Detention Center Facilitator and Administrator, with us in the studio today. Captain Crowder, good morning.
Good morning.
Now, you've been with the Sheriff's Department, I don't want to say a lot of years, because I don't want to show our age or whatever.
Right.
But, and you've held a lot of different positions there at the department. Tell us a little bit about yourself.
Okay.
And what areas that you've worked in the past and what experience that you've had before you took this position as administrator of our detention facility.
Okay. Well, I'd first like to start off by saying I'm a spent 4 years in the Navy, so I'm very proud of that. And I finished up by 4 years and moved back home, mm-hmm. which this is my home, Rockingham County. Lived here all my life and started at the Reasonable Police Department back in 1989. I spent 5 years there and decided to change careers and come over to the Sheriff's Office in 1994.
Right.
And I've held a number of positions throughout the Sheriff's Office. Actually been your supervisor at one point.
That's
so,
true.
So we've been around a time, so we don't want to talk too much on age. But
that's true. That's
I've held the positions of corporal, sergeant on patrol, lieutenant on patrol. I have worked in and out of narcotics several times. I have been a lieutenant in the civil division, mm-hmm. which is one of the high liabilities of the sheriff's office.
Right.
And my most recent tenure is I was promoted to captain over the detention facility back in 2010.
So a lot of experience there coming with the job. And and I will say this, I don't envy you your current job as much as I feel like I work. It seems like every time that I show up at the office, no matter what day it is, no matter what time it is, your car's there when I get there and your car's there when I leave. So I know
right.
that you work a lot
right.
And that you have a big job there at the department. Tell us what your current responsibilities entail there as the administrator over our detention facility. What is it that you do, and what is it that you are responsible for there at the sheriff's office now?
Right. Well, first of all, you've got to think of, when you run a detention facility, it is a it's almost like a business. We run 24/7.
Right.
When other administrators are going home, the jail continues to run as normal, as a business, and it is a we have to provide inmates food. We have to provide inmate help. We have to get them back and forth to court. And we are assessed with housing pretrial inmates for the sheriff's office until they receive a sentence, or they receive a sentence from the court officials here in Rockingham County, depending on where they're determining on how many days they're going to have to stay with them. So we buy a lot of supplies. So it is a business. It's pretty much like a business, and it's run 24/7.
Well, tell me roughly how many employees do you have working there at the jail?
We have approximately I want to say 45 employees. We mm-hmm. have a couple maintenance workers, and my staff includes the bailiffs, which assist during the daytime hours. We have some administrative positions that are involved in determining time and sentences and commitments. We have a lady that assists in taking money orders and handles our money for our canteen service, which we also have to provide by the state.
Okay. Okay. Well, that's a lot of people. Big job. Big job. How many prisoners can this? Now, we've got a new facility.
Yes.
Open up
very
a couple
nice,
years
very
ago.
Nice
very
facility.
Nice facility. tell us how many prisoners the new detention facility can accommodate.
Our facility now can house approximately 232 inmates. We have not reached that capacity as of yet. This past summer, we reached about 220. We were knocking on the door.
Right, right.
But we have a great facility now. I don't know if anybody's came by and took tours early on, but we don't have steel bars anymore. It's all concrete and metal doors. But we are very proud of that facility, and we try to keep it top-notch and clean.
It is state-of-the-art down there, which brings me to our next question. This is this new system is set up as a pod system.
That's correct.
Explain the pod system and what makes it better than the traditional methods used in a detention facility.
Well, I think the best way to describe it is the officers have more interaction with the inmates. They're not put in a cell, and there's no interaction. We have direct supervision in most of our pods. The officer is in those pods 24/7. They make their rounds. They interact with inmates. They help and assist in feeding times, mm-hmm. And getting them medical calls, and pretty much assist them on daily needs, what they need. So they have somebody in there that they can ask questions, you know, pretty much all day and night. Mm-hmm. You know, they have to follow rules just like anywhere else.
Right.
So, you know, that officer's in there to be sure and make sure they follow the rules and instilling good values. So the direct supervision is it's the newest thing out there, and a lot of facilities are going to direct supervision.
It seems to be working really well, too.
It does. It does. Our officer, I have to say, our officer assaults have cut down, mm-hmm. and I can't say what that's attributed to, but it's been working for us.
All right. Well, good deal. Now, the jail is divided into several different pods there, several different
right.
sections. Explain how that works.
Well, the pod system, we have... We have one pod that is our maximum facility pod, and inmates in there do not get as much time out as normal inmates do. And this would be people that was charged with serious felony charges.
The really violent,
right.
serious violent
right.
stuff. Yeah.
And these are people that cannot get along with regular inmates. So sometimes it doesn't always depend on what their charges are. We have a classification scale, mm-hmm. and we have a classification officer that handles that, and she goes through and does a history and runs their record, and depending on how many times they've been in and out of our facility and how many disciplinaries they've had, will determine a point number for them. And from there, they will be assigned a pod. Now, after the max pod, we have a medium pod, and it goes down from there, and we have another low priority medium pod, and then we have a dorm. And I like to tell everybody wants to be in the dorm because they get the most privileges.
Right, right.
So they're out in an open bay, and all the other rooms are two-man rooms and one-man rooms.
That's low-level offenders
right.
and right. such like that. So I got you. Okay, somebody is arrested. They come into your detention facility. What is the procedure? Because one of the new things that we've got that I find really cool is our booking facility and the way that it's set up now. You've got some really cool gadgets in there that
right.
that help us out, state-of-the-art stuff. Tell
right.
us a little bit about that.
Well, once somebody comes into booking, we just went to a new system called OSSI.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not trying to give a disclaimer out there, but that's our new system. And It is state of the art. Once people are booked in, there's a lot of characters that are put into that, and we pack the field, and they're photographed, and we have a biometric scanner.
Mm-hmm.
And what that is, when an inmate or somebody incarcerated comes in, we take their fingerprint. So we also give them a wristband. And depending on their charge, they may or may not be fingerprinted, of course.
Mm-hmm.
But when they are released, or when their time is done, or if they posted bond, we check them out by that same fingerprint. So we have had inmates in the past, and let's be honest, from time to time they will trade wristbands.
Right.
So, but however,
I find it hard to believe that a prisoner will be dishonest.
However, the fingerprints do not lie. So
right, right.
This is another telltale sign to make sure we're releasing the right person.
Right. Now, you mentioned something while you were answering that question that I want to just take a minute to explain, and that is bond. You know, I get a lot of questions. Well, how did that person get out, you know, why was this person let out of jail and stuff like that. Some people don't understand what bond is and what it's there for. Could you explain that for us?
I will try to do that. The magistrates, a local judge, will set bond. And that's a monetary amount of money that a person must post to get out of jail.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not meant to be punishment. It's just an amount that is pre-assessed, and that's what they have to make. And there's a number of ways they can make that, by property bonds, by going through a bail bondsman,
mm-hmm.
or coming up with a monetary amount that is affixed to that by a family member making that amount.
Right. Right.
So there's a number of ways they can make bond.
So that's more of an assurance that you will appear in court to basically have your day in court. It is true.
Correct.
That everyone is innocent until proven guilty.
Correct.
In a court of law.
Correct.
And bond is more or less an insurance policy to ensure that that person is going to appear in court based on the severity of their charges and their history of appearing in court, whether they have had problems in the past or this, that, and the other. That has something to do with it as well.
You are correct. I think that is a very good way of saying it. It is. It's kind of like an insurance policy.
Exactly.
We want to make sure those people get to court.
Okay. Another really great program you guys have there in a detention facility is the GED program. Before the break, tell us a little bit about the GED program and how that's used, who we're partnering with to help people out with that.
Well, we started the GED program back earlier this past year, and we've had some success from it. We are a pretrial facility, which makes it a little harder to do programs and stuff, but mm-hmm. RCC partnered up with us to attempt to try to maneuver this and get some people some help, and where they, if they were confined in our facility, work towards their GED. And they have did this, and we've had some success at it. We've had several individuals get their GED while they were incarcerated at our facility. If they get out, RCC has continued to work with these folks and ensure that they work towards that GED program. So it's been a very beneficial program.
Well, it's good that program exists so that someone who may have made a bad choice, can take advantage of that and try
right.
to better themselves
right.
During the situation instead of serving the time, let the time serve them, so to speak.
Right.
Now, you mentioned that the detention facility is a pretrial holding facility.
Right.
What do you mean by that?
When I say pretrial, that pretty much means that the inmate has not been convicted of a crime yet. So they do have rights. They have more rights. So we want to make sure their rights are taken care of. And it kind of depends on the court system, how long they may be there. The court system, district attorneys, and compiling evidence and documentation for court. So there is no set time they may be there. It just depends on the situation and maybe their charge. So we call them pretrial. Now, once they're sentenced after the court, it depends on the judge and what sentence he's imposed
mm-hmm.
and where they may go at that point.
Okay. All right. And with that, I believe we're on time for our break here. We'll be back right after these messages.
Video production funding provided by the Rockingham County Business and Technology Center. Entrepreneur-focused, technology-enabled, future-driven. Visit our website for additional information, rockinghambusiness.org.
WLOE Eden.
WMYN Mandan.
Listen online all the time.
RockinghamCountyRadio.com.
All right, and welcome back to Community Accents right here on WLOE WMYN. I am Kevin Suthard, your public information officer at the Sheriff's Office. With me in the studio today is Captain Daryl Crowder, who is over in charge of our detention facility here in the county. Now, before the break, you were telling us a little bit about some various things that happen in a jail, some of your responsibilities and all. I want to jump right back into it because there is a long list of stuff that you are responsible for. One of the things that have come about here relatively recently is the misdemeanor confinement program that we at Rockingham County Sheriff's Office participate in. Explain that to our listeners and what that means. What are the benefits from that and so on.
Pretty much the misdemeanor confinement program is run by the North Carolina Sheriff's Association. This is where an inmate may go to court, receive time, and that time has to be from 91 to 180 days. Mm-hmm. And there are certain things that criteria have to be met before they are imposed that sentence. It does have to be a misdemeanor. It cannot be anything with driving while impaired. Mm-hmm. That's one of the criteria that does not meet. And what happens is, basically, is if they get that sentence, that inmate stays with us in our local facility, and we're one of approximately 40 to 50 counties in the state that is participating in the program, and it is a money-making adventure, mm-hmm. and what happens is we make $40 a day that they're here. Now, so that means we're bringing in some revenue for the county.
Okay, all right. Now, it basically costs the same, other than food, it costs the same to have the cells empty as it does to have them filled. And
that's
one of the
correct.
Benefits of these situations are. So basically, other than the food, the county is able to take the rest of that in as revenue, the money that's paid.
That is correct.
How much did we pull in last year doing this?
I don't have the figures in front of me, but approximately $215,000.
Wow. Wow, and that's money that goes back into the system.
Right back to the county.
To help us out doing that. So
right back to the county.
That is awesome right there. Good program in and of itself. Now, let's talk about visitation.
Okay.
I know that's one of the big things that people ask about, too.
Right.
I have a friend or loved one in a jail.
Right.
And I want to come visit them. Can I come on a Tuesday afternoon and go back there and see them, or tell us what the procedure is.
Okay.
You know, when you can come and what times and how that's divided up, because you can't just show up. Some people just show up
right,
and want to visit,
right.
And that's not how it works. So explain that to our listeners.
At the sheriff's office now, we do not have any contact visitation. We have, with our recent jail, we have a monitoring system where the inmate sits down in front of a camera, and his loved one will sit at another camera at another location, and they're able to view and talk. Now, our visitation starts on Friday with females from 1:30 to 3:30 and from 7 to 8:30. So on Fridays is when we allow female visitation. So mm-hmm. we come up with several times there because it's kind of hard for people on Fridays because some of them may be working.
Right.
So we've allowed from 1:30 to 3:30, and then they can come back at night from 7 to 8:30.
Mm-hmm.
Now, on Saturday and Sundays, we have our male visitation, and that time is at 1:30, and it runs to 5 o'clock. And that's on Saturday and Sunday. And, you know, our male population is much greater than our female population. So what we do is divide those days up. On Saturday, visitations for males is from their last name, anything from A to L. And then on Sunday is from N to Z.
Okay.
We go by their last name.
Okay, well, that makes sense. And they can show up during that point in time, and talk on the, they won't actually, you know, physically see the person,
but they
can get on the video recorder and talk to them there in the lobby of the sheriff's office.
Right in the lobby. We have a room designed for that, yes. And we allow 15-minute visits. We do require that someone brings an ID, and we sign that person in. We request that there are no more than four visitors. And the room is fairly big, but if you have children, they can come. But we only allow four visitors because the room is small and the way the cameras are set up.
Right.
So we want to make sure that everybody gets a good visit.
Right, right. Okay. And we are working toward it, and we don't have it yet, but we are working toward it in the future, being able to do some sort of internet connection where you could visit for those that can't make it up to the actual lobby there to
right.
see. You would, of course, pay a fee, and then you would be able to video chat from your home with the inmate during the allotted times. Is that?
That is correct.
That's something we're working on.
That's right. It's called off-site visitation, and we're in the current process now of upgrading our software to get to that point. So we still may be a couple years away, mm-hmm. or a year and a half, but that is one of the things we're looking at. And it'll also be able to assist the attorneys to get over and see their inmates. Well, rather, the attorneys can be at their office and mm-hmm. see. So it'll be a cost-saving factor for them also, mm-hmm. and another way that the county can generate money.
Right. Well, and the upgrading system and all this in and of itself isn't cheap, obviously.
No, exactly.
And the maintenance and upkeep of all of that. But right. It is safer. It reduces contraband into the jail.
Exactly.
Being snuck into the jail and stuff. By doing it like that.
Exactly.
Then so, that's our main focus. All right. Now, let's move on to a different subject here. I say I have a friend or loved one in a jail, and I want to leave them some money.
Okay.
How would I do that, and what are the inmates allowed to spend that money on?
Well, at the detention facility, we're a cashless society.
Right.
So when someone comes in and is booked in, their money is taken and put into property. And from there, I have somebody that does all our accounting, and that money is placed in the bank. And we have what's called an inmate trust fund. And what happens is we monitor that fund with one of our local vendors that provides canteen. And when I say canteen, I mean things like potato chips, mm-hmm. candy bars, even toothpaste. There's a number of things that they can order through this canteen service. And what happens is they're able to bring in the family and friends is able to bring in money orders. And what we do, they can bring those money orders in Monday through Friday from 8:30 to 12 and from 1 to 3 o'clock. So we have to cut it off there because we have to do our accounting and make sure everything, all the money is in. As I said before, we're a cashless society.
Right.
So when an inmate is released, if he has money, he's able to come by after he gets out of the facility, and we do issue him a check. And we do that also Monday through Friday, 8:30 to 12, and from 1 to 4. So we want to make sure they get their money.
Well, of course, that's so that one inmate doesn't try to steal from another or take from another. It's for their safety is the reason why we do it like that.
So. Right.
But they can use that for snacks and, you know, specific things that they want.
It supplements their regular diets and, you know, gives them a little variety because we don't allow all those things in the detention facility.
Okay. No cigarettes, though.
No, absolutely not.
No cigarettes allowed in the jail at all. So.
State law now. No cigarettes, no cell phones.
There you go. Okay. So your money won't be used for that, but they can get some snacks and whatnot. Now, you said earlier that you were in charge also of the court bailiffs.
Right.
Explain the important job that they have. I know that it's one of the things that sets the sheriff's department apart from police departments is that, you know, we are in charge of courtroom security. That's one of the three things of civil process. The county jail, of course, which is your responsibility, and courtroom security. Those are three aspects that the sheriff's office has that police offices are not responsible for.
Right.
So tell us about the court bailiffs and what their job entails and the responsibilities that they have.
They are responsible for monitoring the courtrooms. We have four courtrooms at our new facility at the courthouse. Very nice, I may add.
Very nice, yes.
And they're responsible for monitoring all the security. They're responsible for getting the inmates to and from court. With our new facility, the way the setup is, an inmate does not have the capability of coming in contact with the public at any time other than when he comes into the courtroom.
Mm-hmm.
They leave our detention facility and go through a secure hallway, and we have another secure pod set up where they go into. So it's really set up nice where it keeps everybody safe.
Right, right.
And that's our main goal, safety. But our bailiffs, it's a very demanding job.
Obviously.
They have to articulate the court paperwork, and it's very busy. So very busy. So they're responsible a lot, and they make rounds up there and ensure the safety. So there's a lot of people that come in and out of that courthouse every day.
Yes, there is. Yes, there is. like you, I've held several different positions at the sheriff's office throughout my career. And when I was on patrol or detectives or something like that, and I would arrest somebody, I would have the biggest question I would have generally would come from family members. Well, what about their medications? Are their medical needs going to be? They take pills and this, that, and the other, and I don't have them with me. And I would reassure them about the jail nurse and their needs being taken care of. Tell us about that. You know, I know that medical needs are a big responsibility there at the sheriff's office, and we want to make sure that everybody knows that everybody's medical needs are met within reason. I mean, you know, if they need something, it will be provided for them. So tell us about that.
We have a nurse that is on duty at the sheriff's office detention facility from 8 o'clock to 10 o'clock at night. And they're on staff, and one is on call late at night in case we have a situation that comes up. All our nurses administer the medicine. When someone comes in, after they're booked in, they see our nurse. And the nurse addresses, and she goes through a little background check and assesses that individual to make sure what kind of concerns he's going to have, if he's got any injuries, what kind of medication he takes. And from there, she does her assessment, and sometimes that does play a part in their classification system.
Right.
So, you know, it just depends on their condition of where they'll go and their needs. So what happens is she does, you know, depending on the insurance sometimes, too, that plays a factor in that. She will make sure all the medication is gotten to our facility and the inmates' medical needs are met.
Right. And I think it's important to note that the inmates' medical needs are met, not so much their wants.
Oh, yes.
Medical wants.
Right.
You know, that's what the nurse is there for, to assess them and see what it is that they need as opposed to what they might want to have.
And I think the community would like to know that we do not let anyone have anything narcotic-based, any narcotic-based prescriptions in our facility. So I think, you know, I think the community would be happy to hear that.
Okay. now, you spoke a little earlier about Rockingham County being a pretrial facility. If someone is sentenced, how much time would they spend in the county jail? I mean, is that something that they would spend in our jail if they are sentenced, or would they go somewhere else? If they go somewhere else, where do they go? Tell us about that.
Okay. If, you know, of course, I've talked to you before about the misdemeanor confinement program. They could stay in our facility between 91 and 180 days.
Mm-hmm.
Anything over that, they're usually assigned to go to Division of Adult Corrections, which was formerly known as Department of Corrections.
Right.
They've changed the name. So if they get a larger sentence of that, that's where they're going to usually go. There are times where a judge will, depending on a small sentence, they will spend their time here in Rockingham County. If it's anything over that 180 days, what happens is we get a commitment on them, which is comes through from the clerk's office and the judge, and it assigns the time, the monetary time that they're supposed to, that is imposed upon them. From there, we call them in to the Division of Adult Corrections, and they determine where that person may go. From there, we have transportation officers that transport these folks and get them where they need to go. We like to tell folks so the community knows we are able to tell, after we transport that individual, we're able to tell the loved ones or family members that this person went to a particular facility. We also like to tell them that once they get there, we can't say they will stay there because there's so many facilities in North Carolina, they can be transported right after they get there. But because, you know, they've got their own system. So just because they go to one facility when they leave us doesn't mean they're going to stay there.
Well, a lot of great information about our detention facility and how it works. We're coming up on the end of the program. Before we do reach the end, though, there are a couple of things that I wanted to point out. Important news that has come along the pike here. On Friday, April 12th, Harley Kendall Fulp, age 18, of 131 Lemon Tree Trail in Stokesdale, was arrested in connection with the December 22nd arson at Gideon Grove United Methodist Church on the Gideon Grove Church Road. Now, the other two church arsons that occurred shortly thereafter here in Rockingham County, and I know there was another church that was an attempted arson inside of Guilford County, those are all still being investigated. Mr. Fulp's involvement has not been ruled out in that investigation. However, at this point in time, he has only been charged with the arson at Gideon Grove United Methodist Church. And that arson did result in the total destruction of that church. And with that, we're at the end of the show. We may have actually run over by a minute or so. So I'm going to go ahead and turn it back over to Mike. But we thank you for being with us here on Community Accents with the Sheriff's Office.